Okay, so let's begin. This is the lecture is on text entailment, and of course, this is coming after the last lecture, which was on lexical resources and words and disambiguation. So here, what we mainly covered was some foundational notions like argument frame, selectional preference, and paradigmatic and syntagmatic relations. Paradigmatic relations come from properties of words like dog is a kind of animal. This is hypernemic relationship. Syntagmatic relationships come from co-occurrence. If two words appear in the same corpus or same sentence, same paragraph, so on, then they are said to have a syntagmatic relationship. For example, dog and bark. So we also covered wordnet in detail. Then there was this overlap-based words and disambiguation algorithms, which was emphasized again because these algorithms appear and reappear in WSD literature. Less quaker, conceptual density, page rank, deep learning-based methods, all of them have some form of overlap-based words and disambiguation techniques. Supervised words and disambiguation algorithm is the state of the art in this area, and this requires, of course, sense smart corpora, but the accuracy is close to 60% for general purpose all words WSD. I specifically took PrepNet because I wanted to show the lexical resource for a function word, because most of the lexical resources are for content words, adjective, adverb, noun, verb. How could the lexical resource for a function word look like? And the verb ocean was mentioned because representing verb is always a tricky question. Okay, so this was the recap of the last lecture. Now, for text entailment, we would like to again go to some foundational questions. And text entailment, sentiment analysis, these two problems are really at the highest level of natural language processing. Once we have built all the basic NLP tools and resources, we can think of doing text entailment, sentiment analysis, and so on. We'll see this as we go ahead with text entailment discussions. And again, the entailment problem can be for multiple languages. All languages have the need for text entailment, and different algorithms have to be designed for text entailment. So now, the question of entailment arises because natural languages and the meaning they express, these two things have a particular relationship. Okay, the meaning is expressed in many different ways. This is the notion of variability. For one particular meaning, there can be multiple expressions. And when we go from language to meaning, we encounter ambiguity. So more specifically, linguistics has two terms for this. Ambiguity for words, a single word or a word phrase, is called polysemy. Okay? And when a particular word meaning is expressed by multiple words, we have what is called synonymy. Okay? A set of words can express the same meaning. So the entailment phenomenon arises because of variability of meaning expression in language and language expressions being ambiguous when it goes to meaning domain. So now it is known from a lot of work on text relationships that given two pieces of text, there are typically five elementary relations between them. The two pieces of text can be equivalent in terms of meaning. So T can imply H and H can imply T. T is also called the text, H is called the hypothesis. So if T is Paris is the capital of France and H is the capital of France is Paris, then these two sentences are equivalent. So T implies H, H implies T. There can be forward implication. Paris is the capital of France implies Paris is in France. So this is the notion of forward implication. In backward implication, we have the reverse of hypothesis implying the text. If Paris is in France, then, and Paris is the capital of France, then Paris is in France is implied by Paris is the capital of France. This is backward implication. Independence is almost like opposite of equivalent. The two pieces of text really have nothing to do with each other. Paris is the capital of France, Grenoble is in France. These two facts have really no implication relationships between them. And then there is exclusivity. Paris is the capital of France means that nothing else can be really the capital of France. So that is one exclusivity. And French Parliament is located in Grenoble. If this is H, then we definitely know T implies not of H. The capital must contain the parliament. Okay. So given two pieces of the text, these five elementary relationships hold between two pieces of text. So the text entailment phenomenon is described as follows. It's a directional relation between two sentences. If we have a text T and a hypothesis H, for example, if the text T is Euro, Scandinavian media, cheer, Denmark versus Sweden draw, and H is Denmark and Sweden tie, that means they have a drawn match, then T surely implies or entails H. Text entailment, therefore, is defined as follows. The classical definition of entailment really comes from the domain of logic. A text T entails a hypothesis H if H is true in every circumstance of possible world in which T is true. Okay? So this is really making an appeal to what logic does on predicates. Okay? Predicates and predicate calculus expressions, they are what is called interpreted. And interpretation requires fixing a domain, giving meaning to the constant, giving meaning to the predicates, functions. And you create a world for the logical formula to be interpreted. So similarly, a piece of text has different meanings in different worlds, possibly many times. But a text T would entail a hypothesis H if H is true in every possible world wherever T is true. Now, the applied definition, which is attempted to be algorithmized, is that a text T entails hypothesis H if a human reading of T will infer that H is most likely true. Okay? So, we bring in a human perception of the text, and most likely true again almost takes us to probabilistic approaches. So here are some examples of entailment which have different degrees of difficulty. Some of them are easy, some more difficult. So if the text is Sharon wants Arafat could be targeted, wants Arafat could be targeted for assassination. The hypothesis is Prime Minister targeted for assassination. The entailment is no. The reason is that the two sentences have different modalities. The first sentence talks about a possibility, and the hypothesis talks about an actual event happening. So possibility and actual occurrence cannot have implication. The possible possibility sentence cannot really imply the actual occurrence sentence. The second sentence also shows an example of no entailment. 25 of the dead were members of the law enforcement agencies and the rest of the 67 were civilians. So totally there was 25 plus 67 deaths. The hypothesis says 25 of the dead were civilians, but we know that 67 civilians were there. So this is a case of no entailment because the information is not identical in the two pieces of text. The memorandum noted the United Nations estimated that 2.5 million to 3.5 million people died of AIDS last year. Over 2 million people died of AIDS last year. The entailment is yes. But this requires a little bit of arithmetic to establish correspondence between over 2 million and 2.5 million to 3 million. Okay. So here entailment has to have a module which can do basic arithmetic. Mitsubishi Motor Corporation's new vehicle sales in the US fell 46% in June. Mitsubishi's sales rose 46%. Here entailment is no, because the two information are contradictory. Okay? And this is an easy case of entailment because rise and fall are antonymous to each other. So the events which influence entailment are the following: synonymy. Influences entailment. She was transferred again to Navy when the American Civil War began in 1861. The hypothesis contains the war started. Start and begin are synonyms of each other. Generalization can cause entailment. As of Friday, January 12th, three people in the city had self-immolated. So self-immolation is a kind of suicidal ritual which is done for religious purposes. So the hypothesis contains the word died. Three people died in the city during the month of religious austerities in January. So self-immolation is a kind of dying. This is a situation of generalization, and it shows entailment. World knowledge. This is a situation of cause and effect. Bear attack people. This is a cause-effect presupposition. Okay, if people are to be killed by bear, of course the bear must attack people first. So this is a case of entailment due to cause and effect presupposition and involves world knowledge. Apposition is a very, very frequent case of entailment. The British writer Doreen Lessing, recipient of 2007 Nobel Prize. So hypothesis contains the full sentence: Doris Lessing won the Nobel Prize. The text is giving this information in the form of an apposition. Apposition means a modifier for a noun phrase. So this is another event influencing entailment. Named entity matching. American President Bush signed the document. George Bush signed the document. So Bush and George Bush are co-referential. This is also a case where entailment happens. Modality. The Italian Parliament may approve. Italian royal family returns home. Again, this is a case of no entailment because modality and actual occurrence are not same. Polarity can lead to no entailment. He lied, he never lies. This is a case of no entailment. Passivization is a change in the text form with the same meaning. John gave the book to Tom. Tom was given the book. By whom is not really important, but this entails. Text entails H. And then coreference, named entity was a special case of this. Now this coreference can be very indirect. George Bush came to India, the American president had a meeting with Manmohan Singh, George Bush had a meeting with Manmohan Singh. So Manmohan Singh was the prime minister at the time and Bush had a meeting with him. So there is an indirect coreference which has to be resolved for entailment. There can be noun verb co-indexing. He is the winner of the match. Winner is a noun, or if you want an adjective maybe, he won the match. So this is to be resolved by this noun verb co-indexing. So all these examples, they illustrate this point about variability and ambiguity. The same meaning is expressed in two different forms requiring entailment to be resolved. Okay? And similarly for ambiguity. Now, for text entailment problem to be solved, we need many comparisons, and the comparisons can be at different layers. It could be at lexical layer, where the words are compared. Now, the comparison can be in the syntactic layer. Now, if we have comparison in the syntactic layer, then it can have some resilience with respect to failures in the lexical layer. So this is a property of natural language processing that if we have robustness in higher layer, then the lower layer can be, you can tolerate some error in the lower layers. So if syntactic layer is doing well, then we know we can tolerate some variations in the lexical layer. In particular, if I do parsing, then I can be resilient to the change in word order. In the semantic layer, we can have comparison of word senses, semantic roles, paradigmatic relations, co-occurrence, etc. And in the pragmatic layer, the sentiments and possible worlds are compared. So text entailment requires comparison involving one or more layers of natural language processing. So now we come to the nitty-gritties or the nuts and bolts of text entailment. At the heart of text entailment is what is called text similarity computation. Okay. So at this point of time, I don't know if you have any question or comment on the phenomenon of entailment, because we are now going to get into some nuts and bolts of entailment. Okay. So we're going to discuss text similarity. So there are many different ways of measuring text similarity. Different kinds of techniques are presented here. The first set of techniques is based on bag of words. Okay. Then some techniques make use of permutation. Then n-gram based methods, vector based methods, tree based methods, semantic graph based methods, and feature based methods. Okay. So we would like to look at all these methods of similarity computation, and then the discussion on entailment becomes quite easy and systematic. Bag of words, if we have two sentences S1 and S2, then we can take the content words of S1 and create the bag BS1, take the content words of S2, create bag BS2. Now the similarity between S1 and S2 can be computed by these two formulae called Dice coefficient and Jaccard coefficient. The Dice coefficient is measured by the number of common words between the two sentences divided by the number of content words in first sentence plus the number of contents in the second sentence. Number of content words in the second sentence. So Dice is computed this way. Jaccard is very similar to Dice, except that it counts the common content words in S1 and S2 only once, which is why it takes the union of S1 and S2. And as far as my knowledge of history goes, Dice coefficient came before Jaccard coefficient, and maybe Jaccard tried to solve this lacuna, which is counting words twice in the denominator. Yeah.
I think actually those two are subsumed by something called the Tversky index, which stems from cognitive psychology, I think.
Yeah.
I mean, there are like three parameters that you can vary, and depending on the values you put, you essentially get Dice, Jaccard, Lesk, or other variants.
Lesk, you mean the Lesk algorithm or?
No, the overlap measure between.
Overlap measure, okay. The overlap measure is this.
Yeah.
Okay, and the normalization is done by the denominator, of course. Yeah. Now, I think this was surely a lacuna. Why would you count the content words which are common twice? Okay. So, Jaccard, I believe, solved that problem. So this is bag of words, and Dice and Jaccard coefficients are very well known. Then if the two sentences are essentially permutations of one another, okay, then we have a series of techniques to measure their similarity. The most important possibly is the edit distance based on the order of the words, but Levenstein, for example, is a very well-known measure, which makes use of edit distance in terms of insertion, deletion, substitution. But here we mention a score which is very old, This is the Hamming score, and Hamming score measures the disagreement between the two sentences, which is in terms of sigma I equal to 1 to n xi divided by n. N is the normalizing parameter, and this is this xi is equal to 0 if in the same position you have same word, otherwise it is 1. So it is counting the number of disagreements. The assumption, of course, is that the two sentences are of same length. If that they are of not of same length, then you can, of course, pad fictitious words, okay, for the smaller sentence. So this kind of distance calculation between the two sentences would be useful in free word order languages. Free word order languages express the same thought in multiple different words order, and this would be useful for this. Now, another set of similarity measures are based on the ranking of the words. So here, if we have the sentence John went to school, and if we decide that the rank of the words are as per their order in the sentence 1, 2, 3, 4, then a variation of the sentence is given here, which is 2, 1, 3, 4. So here the verb has come to the front. This can, for example, happen in Arabic. Okay, Arabic has the option of putting the verb in the front, and many times in other languages we can have this. So in such cases, we can have a rank-based similarity computation. So amongst them, possibly the most famous is Kendall's tau distance score. So we look upon the words in sentence 1 and words in sentence 2 as coming from two random variables, as being observations of two random variables x and y. So we have correspondences x1, y1, x2, y2, xn, yn, etc. And we have this notion of concordance and discordance. Pair xi, yi and xj, yj are concordant if the ranks for both the elements agree. That is, if both xi is greater than xj and yi greater than yj, or if both xi less than xj and yi less than yj. Okay. Otherwise, the pairs are called discordant. Now, if xi equal to xj or yi equal to yj, then the pair is neither concordant nor discordant. Now, the Kendall-Tau's distance score measures the number of concordant pairs, subtracts the number of discordant pairs, and divides it by the total number of possible pairs of comparison, which is like a normalization. The Kendall-Tau score is between minus 1 and plus 1, perfect agreement to perfect disagreement. So this would again be applicable if I look upon the words in a sentence as ranked order of words. So Kendall-Tau is a measure. The second measure is Spearman rank correlation coefficient, which also comes with the Microsoft Excel package as an automatic formula computation. So here the correlation is measured by distance from mean of the two random variables, take their product, sum them for all observations, divided by the product of standard deviation of the two random variables. Okay. So a positive correlation will be showing that the two sentences are similar. Negative correlation will show otherwise. So it makes use of the word order, and there is a notion of rank for the words. Now we move to n-gram based matching. All this was based on words: Dice, Jacquard, Kendall-Tau, Spearman, everything is at the level of words. Now we go to n-gram based matches, and we know of an extremely well-known measure called the Blue score, which came from machine translation evaluation research. So this Blue score is essentially saying that for the two sentences, try to say how many n-grams match. Okay. So the higher the number of matches of n-gram, more similar are the two sentences, and the higher is the evaluation score in terms of machine translation. So there is this factor called brevity penalty, which is imposed because a short sentence with common words with a longer sentence always has the possibility of finding good engram matches. But that short sentence need not be a very good output from the machine translation system. Okay? So, to correct that error, the evaluators produced a, or the proposers of the evaluation scheme gave this brevity penalty, which multiplies the blue score. This is the brevity penalty. And this part is essentially saying that take the n-grams, n varying from 1 to the length of the sentence or as many as you want. So, collect those n-grams and see how many of them match, divide it by the total number of n-grams and get a score. This formula effectively is the weighted geometric mean. Now, there is a notion of clipping, which again comes from the requirement of machine translation evaluation. So, if the machine translation output produces a single word which appears in the reference translation, then we will get very high score on n-gram matching, because this word will match, this whole output will match very well with the reference translation. Suppose the reference translation is the sky is blue, the sky is blue, and the machine translation system outputs the 3-4 times. Then we know that at every position of the machine translation output there is a match, but this whole output is a complete nonsense. Okay? So, to account for that kind of anomaly, they introduce this factor called clip factor, where the count is count has a ceiling of the maximum number of matches. Okay? And that is introduced so that this anomaly is removed. But anyway, the blue score remains a good inspiration for any evaluation which is based on n-gram. Another n-gram based well-known score is used for text summarization. That's called the Rouge score, R-O-U-G-E, Rouge score. That is also based on the n-grams. So, from words and n-grams, we move to the vector based similarity calculations. This kind of evaluation measure really came from information retrieval. The idea was to match the query with the document and produce a ranking for the documents depending on its relevance. Now, relevance is a very, very difficult and subtle notion. When is a document relevant to a particular query? It's very difficult to decide that. But you can approximate relevance by insisting on a good match, at least at the surface level, between the query and the document. So, what happens is that the term frequency is matched. Term frequency is also weighted by something called IDF, inverse document frequency. So, a vector is created from the two sentences. This vector is consisting of components which are term frequency multiplied by the inverse document frequency. And in our case, the IDF is computed as follows. Find out how many times the word appears in that sentence. This is the number. And find out the number of sentences in which the word find out the total number of sentences. So, this is total number of sentences divided by total number of sentences in which a particular word appears. That is the inverse document frequency of the word. So, this multiplies by the term frequency, and then we have a cosine similarity measure. Now, why is IDF introduced? IDF is introduced to give importance to words which are really distinguishing words. Some words are very typical of a particular set of sentences. So, we give importance to that. And the idea really comes from information retrieval. The next kind of similarity measure is based on more complex structures. So, tree-based similarity. The first set of such measures is on the constituency tree. Suppose the number of nodes in the parse tree of first sentence is n1 and the number of nodes in the parse tree of second sentence is n2, and m is the number of nodes matched in a particular order of traversal. So that order of traversal could be pre-order, in-order or post-order, and the similarity is computed as m, the number of nodes matched between the two trees, divided by maximum of n1 and n2, okay, maximum of the total number of nodes in the two trees. Why max and not mean? Max would be a more conservative measure, that means it will give produce lower number for the same matching. If I have mean here, then it will produce a higher number, okay. So we just have a different scale depending on max and mean. If the trees are dependency, then the matching is a little more complex. The similarity computation is a little more complex. Obviously, intuitively speaking also, if there are two dependency trees, then dependency tree we know consists of dependency relations, okay, and arguments within these dependency relations. Dependency relations are always like a binary predicate, a predicate with two arguments. So to match two dependency trees, we have to match their dependency relations and match their constituent arguments. That is the main idea. So that intuition is captured in the formula here. There are three parts in the matching expression: match the relations, match the first arguments of the relations, match the second argument of the relations. This delta is Kronecker delta, which returns 1 if the two arguments match, otherwise it returns 0. And the weightages are given to relation matching, first argument matching, second argument matching. And the total number of matches are gathered together, multiplied by the weights given to matching, divided by the total number of dependency relations in the two trees. Again, we take max so that we have a conservative number. Now, the question is, why have different weightages? So, when we are matching two sentences, okay, then what is important? In the sentence, are semantic relations important or the words themselves more important? Okay. So, to decide that, we can play with the weightages here, WR2, ARG1 and WR. We play with these weights and we create a good similarity measure which captures the reality. After all, what is the purpose of these similarity measures? These similarity measures should capture reality. When the two sentences are really close in meaning, they should be captured. Now, often there is high weightage given to relationship because if the words are same, okay, then of course you will get a match. But if there is an agent and object reversal, then the two sentences of course differ in meaning. John likes Jack and Jack likes John. Both the two sentences will have same bag of word similarity. The words are all same. N-gram similarity also will be same, even vector based similarity will be same. But their relationships are very different. In one case John is the agent, in the other case Jack is the agent. So that will be captured by dependency relation matching and giving weightages. Now all these different matches and similarity measures can be combined together and we can produce an extremely rich similarity computation, which can be making use of these features. So here I record 9 features. So we can pick up some of the features randomly. For example, the first feature is length. If the two sentences have same length, then this would be an equality of integer matching, integer equality computation on integer. Then if it is active voice and passive voice matching, then active returns 1, passive returns 0. Again, we have to match equality. If one sentence is the passive version of another sentence, then it will be a feature here in the similarity computation. Similarly, you could have very complex feature which makes use of a lexical resource. If you look at the ninth feature, for example, frame semantic representation of the sentence as per frame net. So get the representation of the sentence from in the form of a frame semantic representation. So that will be a slot filler structure, and we have to perform an equality or subset check on the slots and their fillers. This will go as a feature, and we have a decision based on these features. Now all these features can be collected together, and we can feed it into a classifier. Okay? So the classifier will either say yes or no on the similarity, or it can produce a score, okay, like a confidence score in a support vector machine, for example. And the input is, of course, this set of features, which are obtained from many different sources, using many lexical resources, using different checks. Okay? And the measure can be seen up there, which is the feature set of first sentence, feature set of second sentence, I and R are the two sentences, let's say, normalized by weightages, which were multiplying these features. We can give different weightages to different features. And then finally, we can do matching of the two sentences at the deep semantic level. Okay? So we would get complete words and disambiguation done, get all the semantic relations very precisely, get all the speech acts like tense, number, pragmatic attributes like emphasis, focus. And these kind of things are captured very well in a semantic framework called universal networking language. So here, the deep semantic based matching I'll describe when we describe our work on use of UNL on text entailment. Okay? So this discussion finishes the similarity computation between two sentences, and this is very, very useful, extremely useful for text entailment. It comes as a module. Okay, so now we move to the applications of text entailment. Text entailment actually has been called really one of the pillars of natural language processing, because it can be used in machine translation for evaluation of machine output with reference translation. Summarization is looked upon as an application of entailment. The summary produced from the text should be faithful to the original text. Okay? So the original text should imply the summary. Okay? So that's where the entailment question comes in. Now this is not too much of a problem, because in summarization, we have two kinds of summarization. One is abstractive summarization, the other is extractive summarization. In extractive summarization, we pick up important sentences from the original text and put them together. Of course, there is this question of coherence. Are the sentences ordered properly? If they are not ordered properly, the sentence, the summary will sound incoherent. But if you leave that out, then extractive summary will not really face a big problem in terms of entailment violation. That will not happen. But this is a point to keep in mind. Reading comprehension is looked upon as an application of entailment, because after a person has read a passage, to test his or her understanding of the passage, we can give questions. And the questions will be answered by the person who has read the piece of text. That answer should be implied or entailed by the original passage. Okay? This is the role of text entailment in reading comprehension. Information retrieval is a case of text entailment, because the query should imply the document, should entail the document. Then entrance examination and reading comprehension are similar. These are applications of entailment. Question answering also is of similar kind. So here is an example. Question, does John speak French? The given query is converted into the hypothesis, John speaks French. And in that text, in the reading comprehension passage, there was a sentence, John is a fluent French speaker. Now, T definitely entails H, so H is correct. So there is this entailment situation to see if the answer is really the answer of the question or not. And there are work in this line using entailment. Now, we can go to different approaches of text entailment. The approaches can be grouped as word based, dependency based, natural logic based, probabilistic approach, machine learning based, and graph based approaches. So, we can take a look at them. Now, bag of word matching, this has been discussed in detail through Dice coefficient and Jaccard coefficient and so on. So, here we see that the text is iTunes has seen strong sales in Europe. This is the text. Hypothesis is strong sales for iTunes in Europe. The hypothesis is not even a complete sentence. It is a noun phrase. Okay? And is this noun phrase entailed by the text, which is iTunes has seen strong sales in Europe. Now, here we can see that bag of words will do very well. Okay? We simply take the bag of words and this will be completely a subset of the words in the text. So, it will give a high score and therefore signal entailment. Now, the interesting thing is that the score will remain high even if you introduce a negation somewhere. Okay? iTunes has not seen strong sales in Europe. Now, still the matching will be with high value and entailment will answer will be still yes. So, negation handling cannot be done if you have bag of words based entailment decision. That is very shallow. Dependency tree based entailment, of course, we would like to match the dependencies and their arguments. If the text is John bought a book, then from John bought a book, this is the output of the Stanford parser. We have the root, which is the start of the dependency tree. N sub is the subject relationship between John and bought. Who bought the book? John. And what did he buy? Book, that is the direct object, determine a relationship between A and book. Now, the same parser for passive voice sentence, a book was bought by John, produces this tree. Determiner is of course there. N subject passivization is book and bought. So, book is the subject of the sentence, but it is not really the, it is actually the object. Okay? So, you have this N subject pass. Auxiliary pass, bought and was, an agent of buying is John. So, to match these two trees and detect entailment, we have to establish correspondence between agent and N subject, direct object and N subject pass, and the auxiliary pass also will be an important information in this whole matching. Okay? So, one can see that the two dependency trees will not match as such directly. We will have to augment the dependencies by the information that N subject pass and D obj are same. Okay? So, the matching will have to be supported by rules for doing this. But anyway, this is another approach. In logic based approaches, use is made of predicate calculus. And this is very similar to dependency based matching because each dependency relation is like a predicate. So, the matching happens by or the entailment happens by theorem proving algorithms. So, if we have this sentence here in text, Leonardo da Vinci painted the Mona Lisa, and the hypothesis is Mona Lisa is the work of Leonardo da Vinci. See the phenomenon of variability. The same thought is expressed in very different ways. Leonardo da Vinci painted the Mona Lisa. Mona Lisa is the work of Leonardo da Vinci. It is not even a passive voice sentence. Okay, the focus changes from Leonardo da Vinci to Mona Lisa, because the front of a sentence is always a very, very important sensitive part of the sentence. So we have a predicate here: is painter of Mona Lisa da Vinci, is the work of da Vinci Mona Lisa. Okay, now we have to produce a rule for all x, for all y: is painter of xy entails is work of yx. So the system will have to be given this additional piece of knowledge, and then the entailment will go through. The other kind of logic based approach is much simpler, but there is an enormous amount of entailment in the corpus, evaluation corpus, which is of either upward monotonicity kind or downward monotonicity kind. So upward monotonicity is x subset of y entails fx subset of fy for appropriate f. So if we have chair, which is a subset of furniture, furniture is a collection of chair, table, etcetera, etcetera, then broken chair is a subset of broken furniture. So this will be entailed. Chair being a subset of furniture entails broken chair is a subset of broken furniture. Yeah.
In this context, we're looking
towards what you are saying. Yeah.
Would it not be more accurate to have broken chair is subsumed by there exists broken furniture with an existential operator?
Yes, yes, yes. So I think the discussion we had between me and Wojtek was universal versus existential. This is upward monotonicity for appropriate f, and then there can be downward monotonicity for appropriate function g. X is a subset of y entails g y is a subset of g x. So for example, if the g function is doesn't, then if hover, since hover is a manner of flying, hovering plane for example, doesn't fly is a subset of doesn't hover. Okay, so this is automatically entailed because of the nature of the function. And the not actually is doing entailment because the law of contraposition work is working here. P implies Q is equivalent to not Q implies not P. Now on this upward and downward monotonicity, a system has been built using this idea. It is called the net lock system, which is supposed to be an important piece of development in text entailment. The system does linguistic pre-processing first, then does alignment, and then does the entailment decision. So let me explain alignment. It is very similar to the idea of Levenstein distance. So if we have two sentences here, the left sentence is few states completely forbid casino gambling. The next sentence is few states have completely prohibited gambling. Okay. So here a pointer will run over the two sentences. So for few states the pointer will just advance without modification. Then the second sentence has have, so it will have an insertion recorded. Completely and completely advance without any modification. Forbid and prohibited will be a substitution. Casino to nothing is a deletion. Gambling advance without modification. So that from the two sentences we get all those segments which are unmodified. We get the insertions, we get the deletions, and we get the substitutions. So the situation is very similar to computing the Levenstein distance between the two sentences. And after this alignment has been obtained, what does alignment mean here? Alignment means identical pieces of text in the two sentences, deletion and insertion alignment, and substitution alignment. After this is done, a classifier can take these information and then produce an entailment decision. Of course, there has been a lot of work on probabilistic approach to entailment. So, the probabilistic definition of entailment is very intuitive. Okay. However, it can have a mathematical paradox, which I'll point to you. Now, it says that the entailment is true. A text entails a hypothesis if the probability of the hypothesis given the text is more than the probability of the hypothesis a priori, unconditional probability. So, if the conditional probability of the hypothesis given the text is more than the unconditional probability of the hypothesis, then T entails H. This is a very intuitive and reasonable definition. However, there can be a paradox which, you know, we should try to think about and resolve. If we apply Bayes' theorem and then cancel terms, you can have probability of T given H greater than probability of T. Okay. So, this definition seems to imply that T entails H if and only if H also implies T. But we know that this is clearly false. Okay. Paris is the capital of France, entails Paris is in France. But Paris is in France doesn't entail Paris is the capital of France. Okay. So, for example, Grenoble in France doesn't entail that Grenoble is the capital of France. Okay. So, where exactly is the paradox? This is something I'd like you to think about, because the definition of entailment in terms of this probability seems to say that the opposite is also true. Okay. Because from this probabilistic expression, you arrive at an equivalent formula, which is probability of T given H is greater than probability of T. Okay. So, conditional probability of H should be more than unconditional probability of H, then T implies H. But equivalently, it also means that conditional probability of T given H is bigger than unconditional probability of T, and that is equivalent to H implying T. Okay. So, this paradox should be resolved. Now, the question is, how do we get the probability, unconditional probability of H, and the conditional probability of H given T? How do we get these probabilities? Okay. For that, we first make an independence assumption. So, probability of H given T is converted to probability of product of content words of H given the text T. This is the product. Now, T is of course a collection of words, it is a sequence of words. So, which probability should I consider? Probability of a particular word given in H given the whole text T, which word out of T should I consider? So, we should consider that word which gives me the maximum probability of U given the word V from the text. Okay. And for that, of course, we need to define the probability of U given T. So, this probability is defined in terms of co-occurrence. It is calculated as follows. This is the lexical entailment probability. Probability of U given V is computed by finding out the number of documents in which U and V appear together, divided by total number of documents in which only V appears. So, this is essentially calculating the co-occurrence probability. Co-occurrence probability is being looked upon as same as lexical entailment probability. So, these co-occurrence probabilities or LEPs, they are multiplied together to obtain the entailment decision. This is the probabilistic approach to entailment. Finally, of course, there is this deep semantic approach, and this is an approach which we have investigated in our research group. This is based on the UNL. Now, UNL is a tool for representing text in terms of semantic relations between entities. It has three important constituents: the universal words, which are unambiguous representation of words; attributes, which provides information about how a concept is used in the sentence; and relations, these capture the semantic dependency between constituents. Here is an example. Bush signed a document. Here there is a signing activity. This is the main verb or main predicate of the sentence. It is expressed here. ICL do shows that sign is a transitive verb. This is as per the UNL construct. Then document ICL writing shows that this is a noun and it is a form of writing. Bush instance of person shows that it is a proper noun and referring to the US president at that time. The semantic relations are agent and object, and this is a complete meaning representation of the sentence. Okay, this is the goal of UNL. Now, the approach is very simple. Given the text and the hypothesis, we obtain the UNL graphs for both and pass it through an entailment engine, which gives a score with respect to entailment. Okay, high score means entail, low score means no entailment. Now, the system also has many modules which interact together, but I draw your attention particularly to the left column and the right column. In the right column, we have dependency trees produced from the text and the hypothesis. So, a text graph is produced, hypothesis graph is produced, and there is a fuzzy substitute matching which gives different weightages to relation matching, argument matching, second argument matching, as was described before. And then it goes to an entailment scoring block. On the left hand column, we have the UNL graph from the text, UNL graph from the hypothesis. Then there is something called growth rules. I will show an example of that. Then there are matching rules. There is a thresholding done, contradiction detection done. And then finally, an entailment decision is produced through yes or no. Now, the question is, why do we have the right column? Okay. Is it not enough to have UNL based matching? The reason is that the UNL technology is still developing. Okay, the UNL graphs are not produced with 100% accuracy, and many times maybe the semantic role is not correct, or the disambiguated word is not correct, or the speech act is not correct, and many times the graph also is not produced at all. So, there are limitations on the UNL generation system. So, to augment the UNL based matching, we ought to, you know, correct the lacunae of the UNL based matching, we support it by dependency graph matching. Okay. So, when we get the two scores from dependency score and dependency graph matching and UNL graph matching, we weight them and add them together to get the entailment decision. So, this is supported by something called the growth rule, which is exactly like what we did for logic based system. So, painter off implies work off. Okay. So, that is like a rule which is added to the matching module. Here we add a rule that if Y is the agent of the verb B, then there is an AOJ semantic relationship between the noun N and Y. So, here Y painted. Okay, Y painted something. This is saying Y is the painter of. Okay. So, essentially we have this kind of rules introduced into the system and we call them the growth rule. So, any rule based entailment system needs the support of this kind of augmented rules, which capture the syntactic similarities. The basic semantic engine actually does a matching. So John came from Delhi, John was in Delhi. We know that the text T entails this hypothesis. If we get the semantic graph or the UNL graph from the text, then we will see that John was in Delhi is captured by the semantic relation place, PLC. And the place from relationship is obtained here in this sentence. Place to relationship is obtained if we had John came from Delhi to London. Okay. Then this PLC, PLF, PLT, all these relations are taken, source is also relation, and the entailment is based on those relations. This again becomes a feature based classification problem. So there can be an additional module which is for thresholding, because complete match many times doesn't happen. Some of the relations generated by UNL machine are not fully correct. Resources also may not be sufficient to get all the similarity. And contradiction detection is a necessity. The presence of not should be detected. Negation can completely derail the entailment system. It can be very, very misleading. And it is very innocuous, very harmless looks like, but it can completely change the entailment. Antonymy also has the same role. Contradiction has to be detected. So the help from dependency module is to give support to the UNL based system. So as I said, the score from UNL based system is multiplied by weight beta, score from the dependency based system is multiplied by 1 minus beta. By varying beta, we can give more importance to UNL based system and dependency based system. Now, when shall we give high value to beta? When we want to give more weightage to UNL. When will that happen? That will happen when the pieces of text are well formed, so that UNL graph can be easily obtained, or when we have more confidence in the UNL system. Okay? Then we know that the UNL will produce good graphs, therefore beta can be given high value. Now, the evaluation for entailment happens by a very standard benchmark framework. This is called the RTE challenge, recognizing text entailment. This started in 2005. RTE 1, 2, 3 were conducted under the umbrella of Pascal, pattern analysis, statistical modeling, and computational learning. RTE 4 to 7 were under the umbrella of NIST, National Institute of Standards and Technology in USA. And RT 8 was organized as a part of SEMEVAL 2013. SEMEVAL has become a very standard forum for semantic relations, words and disambiguation, etc., etc. And every RT challenge had its own characteristic feature. So we see that RT 1 in 2005 was covering areas of information retrieval, question answering, information extraction, machine translation. RT2 introduced summarization. RT3 introduced something called average calculation possibly. Then knowledge based pattern matching was introduced and so on and so forth. Another interesting point is the output task. The output can be two-way. Two-way means entailed and not entailed. It can be three-way, which is little more detailed. The case of non-entailment is either contradiction or insufficient information. And it could be five-way with much more granularity. Now, I would like to talk about our experiments on workshop on machine translation data as a proof of utility of entailment for machine translation evaluation. Okay. So maybe in about 10 minutes we'll discuss this part. So The WMT dataset, workshop on machine translation dataset, has these five corpora, French to English translation, German to English, Spanish to English, Czech to English, and Russian to English. Each of the files contains 3,000 sentences as reference, and the whole task was considering human ranking for finding the correlation. So I suppose the task is clear. The task is that every participant in this competition would come up with their evaluation scheme for evaluating the output of these five machine translation systems. In every case, the output is English, okay? And the evaluation measure will have at its input the output from the machine translation system, the English sentence, and the reference. And it will produce a score which will be correlated with the human score. Whichever evaluation measure has high correlation with human ranking will be considered a good evaluation score. So, our proposed measure was this. We combined Blue score, which is an n-gram based matching, Hamming score, which considers permutation, Kendall Tau score, again permutation, Spearman, again permutation or ranking, Shallow semantics, which is the dependency parser, and Deep semantics, which is EMNL. So, we have considered all possible or a number of possible similarity measures, weighted them, okay, and combined them. We call this score the layered score because it is at different layers of natural language processing. So, we see that we are giving importance to the high weightage to shallow matching and to blue matching, okay. That is because we have confidence in the output of the dependency parser, and we are giving high weightage to blue because it is considering n-gram match. Now, deep semantic matching cannot be done if the sentence is ill-formed, parser will fail, for example, okay. And Hamming and KTD, of course, these take care of permutation variations. So, how did our score perform in different settings compared to other evaluation measures? So, the first row shows our evaluation metric, the layered metric. For French English, the metric produced a correlation of 0.97 with human judgment, okay, which was pretty high. So, for French English, all scores did well in terms of correlation with human judgment, but we are doing slightly better than other metrics. For German English machine translation, Meteor, which considers synonymy also into its evaluation measure, that did the best. For Hindi English, we did pretty well, very high correlation with human judgment. For Czech English, NIST measure was best. For Russian English, it was layered, our measure. And on the average, we seem to be doing better than others. That is because of the high score in Hindi English. Here you can see Meteor is very low, 0.45 only. But Blue again has maybe a good performance in many of these systems, that is why it is coming second. Correlation with Blue and human judgment. So, how does our evaluation measure correlate with Blue's ranking and human judgment? So, here we find that the correlation of blue with human judgment is the red one, okay, is the red one, and correlation of layered with human judgment, this is the green one. So, we are always doing better in terms of correlation with human judgment than blue. However, the correlation of layered with blue is has variability, especially for German English, it is low. And this is the correlation table. Okay. So now we can look at some examples and analyze those behavior. So if I take this sentence, for example, the reference is the film will be followed by coffee, tea, and cake. This is the reference translation. The candidate from the output of a machine translation system is after the film, there are coffee, tea, and cake. Blue metric gives a score of 0.35, Hamming gives 0. That's because the whole permutation is wrong. There is no match at the corresponding positions. KTD gives a value of 0.38, Spearman is 0.85, Shallow is 0.53, Deep is 0.87, and we give 0.52. Deep semantics is UNL based system. This gives very high score because of the semantic roles coming out properly, they are being matched well. And we give low score because we try to combine many scores which are not doing so well. Example 2 is reference, a Republican strategy to counter the re-election of Obama. A Republican strategy to counter Obama's re-election. This is really a paraphrase. The two sentences are really equivalent. So here we give a score of 0.75. Deep gives exact match, 1.00. The semantic relations and arguments are all matching very well. The third case is of a reference translation with two different candidates from two different machine translation output. So here again there is entailment. HRT minister proposed a plan of new IITs. This is the name of the human resource development minister. This is the education minister. And the whole issue is named entity matching really. We are not doing so well, it is 0.73, deep semantics 0.9, shallow 0.9, Spearman 7.4, KTD is doing very well, 1.00, okay. Hamming is 0.25, blue is 0.58. Then if we have this sentence, references in addition 5 million new voters in 2012 do not have such identification. In addition, 5 million new voters in 2012 does not have such ID. So identification is replaced by ID, and does not is wrong grammatically, should be do not. And second candidate is in addition, 5 million new voters in 2012 do lack such identification. Here does not have and lack are equivalent, and do is for emphasis. There is additional emphasis there. So for the first candidate, the score is 0.76, for the second candidate is 0.58. It is not able to capture very well the correlation, the relationship between lack and does not have. The fifth case is reference, in a police interview, he said he ran an office at his home address as well as workplace, and clients would call at his house on legal business. This is a long sentence, has complexity in terms of clauses and so on. In a police interrogation and interview, said that his office at his home address as in the workplace, and that his clients because of labor visited at home as well. This is a completely ill-formed sentence. Candidate 2, during police interrogation, he said that he operated an office at your home address. There is what is called adequacy violation. The meaning is distorted. So the workplace and the clients due to work issues visiting them at time. So this is also a bad translation, but in between the phrases are well formed. Okay, and also there is meaning distortion. So as we can see, the deep semantics-based measure gives a very low score, which is fine. 0.42 for the next sentence, which is also low, and we give very low score for both. That's because all measures are combined together and we detect that there has been fluency and adequacy, both violations in the sentence's output. In example 6, it was only the second time he had competed with Toffee and we were all ecstatic when he won. All these are sentences from the machine translation WMT database. It was only the second time that he had taken part in a competition with Toffee and we were all excited when he won. Excited, ecstatic, Toffee capital, Toffee small here. I was the second time that it had participated with Toffee in a competition and we are enthused everyone when it won. So this is a very, very ill-formed sentence. So there is, it is very difficult to produce any deep semantic graph here, okay. So we see a low score of 0.19, little higher score 0.35. We differentiate the two sentences much wider, 0.44, 0.29. You can see that Spearman is very close, 0.79, 0.76, even though the second sentence is very, very bad in quality compared to the first one. Example 7 is a short sentence. I saw a man with a blue umbrella. Candidate 1, with a blue umbrella, I saw a man. I saw a man with a blue umbrella. A man with a blue umbrella, I saw. You know, different variations, but meanings are very different. I saw an umbrella with, I saw a man with a blue umbrella is ambiguous. The second sentence is not ambiguous. Third one is also not ambiguous because of the comma. So how do we perform? Now deep semantics gives a score of 1 for the first sentence, second one 0.87, third one it gives a very low score 0.29. A man with a blue umbrella I saw, maybe it thinks that it is not well formed, okay, and maybe it did not produce a good graph at all. So for us, we give a high score to the second one and moderate scores to the first one and the third one. Hamming gives 0 for two cases. So that's all, and all it showed was that there is a scope for making use of text similarity and entailment ideas for machine translation evaluation. And it is possible to combine many such scores to create a good evaluation measure. This particular layered score will be part of the Moses kit very soon, and it can be used along with the source code of Moses. Okay, thank you.